story of survival, our survival. To survive, we will need more and more energy.
Well, we have oil in the North Sea, gas and coal and nuclear power at the moment. We're quite surprisingly fortunate compared with other people. Unfortunately, the coal is difficult to get. We can expand our coal production, but not easily. Very difficult to go on producing as much as we're getting at the moment. Oil and gas we can get more of for about 15 years, and then it's going to start to decline quite quickly. In fact, the Forties field will start to go into decline in about 1982. That's the first of our new oil fields. So the oil's going to run out, and the gas is going to run out. The coal will run out much later, perhaps 40, 50, perhaps even 100 years later. So they're not going to fill the gap, this gap that's going to arise. There's an obvious answer, of course. You fill it with nuclear power.
At present, only 4% of our energy is supplied by nuclear power. When, in about 20 years from now, the coal, oil and gas begin to run down, it's proposed to expand the nuclear power program to supply up to 18% of our energy needs. 15 nuclear power stations have been built around our shores, and it's estimated that up to 30 more will be necessary by the year 2000 to keep pace with our demands. Here at Windscale, British Nuclear Fuels operate and develop the vital services which keep our nuclear reactors going. Managing Director Con Alday is confident they have the answers to our energy gap.
If we're going to maintain our standard of living with all the household appliances that we all enjoy, let alone increasing it, we are going to need some further source of energy before the end of the century. I think that the only proven source is nuclear. I see no real objection to it. It is in fact, it's safe, it's clean, and it's cheap. It is certainly the cheapest form of energy we have in this country. I think we have to expand it.
One of the most important claims of the nuclear industry concerns its fuel. Coal, oil, and gas can be used as sources for other chemicals and possibly even foodstuffs. Uranium, the nuclear fuel, can only be used for burning in a reactor.
This uranium oxide pellet, for instance, is the equivalent of a ton and a half of coal. It goes inside a fuel pin. Here is a typical fuel pin, and that is the equivalent of 85 tons of coal. So that with uranium, I am confident that we can close the gap, and I'm sure that we shall have to use it in order to do so, not only to maintain our present standard of living, but hopefully to expand it. Well, the reactors on this site have been operating for well over 20 years, and we've never had a serious accident here. Compare us with other energy industries. As far as this country is concerned, as far as I know, there has been no attributable death due to radiation. Look at the coal mining industry, look at the oil industry, look at the North Sea recently. But of course, there is nothing new about radioactivity. It has always been with us. There's radioactivity in the rocks, many rocks, granite particularly. Radioactivity coming in from outer space, so that it has always been there. In fact, I can well remember that before the war, mineral waters were advertised as containing radioactivity and that it was good for you. The radioactivity that the nuclear industry produces is only about 0.1% of the total radioactivity surrounding us.
Proposed ways to dispose of highly radioactive waste are to introduce it beneath the Earth's crust, bore holes in the seabed for deep burial, allow the waste to lie upon the deep ocean floor, bury the waste beneath the ice of the polar caps, bury the waste in salt mines or in shafts mined in granite or clay, propel the waste into orbit around the Earth, fire the waste by rockets into the sun. At Harwell, we asked Dr. Frank Feetz, the man responsible for researching the practicality of underground burial, how long we have before a decision must be made.
We really have as long as we wish to study underground disposal or the alternative of putting waste into the sea in the long term, because they can be stored perfectly safely on the surface. This will be glassified material. The wastes are converted into large glass blocks, which will have two problems associated with them. One is that they will give off heat for quite a long period. They're rather like storage radiators, but they will continue to give off heat for a few hundred years. And the other is the radiation. So what we're really doing is looking to the future for an alternative to storage on the surface, which will be much more acceptable because they'll be out of sight.
What kind of burial points, if I may call them that, are you looking for?
Well, there are three types of structure which appear suitable. Clays seem very suitable because we can drill into them cheaply, we could put these glass blocks into them, and the holes we created would seal up, so they would just be incorporated within the clay structure. Salt is another possibility. A lot of work has been carried out on salt in America particularly, but also in Germany. And the third area where we want to carry out research is into hard rocks like granite. Now, these haven't been looked at before because it's very expensive to drill into granite. But what we want to do with the French is to see whether they might be possible rocks for containing the waste.
There are several watchdog organizations concerned with the safety of the industry. Radiation physicist Frederick Morley belongs to one of them, the National Radiological Protection Board.
Any operation which gives rise to the radiation exposure of people must be justified. And by justified, I mean that the overall benefit of the operation must be greater than the overall risk. The second fundamental recommendation is that doses must be kept as low as is reasonably achievable. In other words, one must proceed to the limit of cost effectiveness. And the third fundamental recommendation is that under no circumstances must individuals, whether they are workers or members of the public, under no circumstance, I repeat, must they exceed prescribed, specified levels of dose.
If one does accept that there is now a safe method of the ultimate storage of these dangerous nuclear wastes, why do you believe there's been such an international protest against the idea of going ahead with any large-scale reprocessing?
Well, I think it's a complex question and a rather emotional one. I think when the public concern was first expressed, it really was concentrated on the waste problem and the safety of the industry. I believe that we have satisfied people in general on that point. Certainly we in the industry are completely satisfied, and I think governments are satisfied. If people have any lingering doubts, I hope this program has helped to dispel them. I think the real worry now, and it is a topic of major concern, is the fact that we extract plutonium from this irradiated fuel. We extract it to reuse it as an energy source in reactors. But plutonium, of course, is the material which is used to make atomic bombs. The form in which we extract it here is not, however, the form in which it is used for bombs. Let me make that quite clear. I think it would be a very wrong step if we sacrificed this major source of energy because of this fear. I think that, first of all, if we deny a reprocessing service to other countries, they're going to be persuaded to build their own plants. The technology is fairly well known, so that you're not going to... You can't uninvent reprocessing. People can do it. We are fortunate in this country in that we're in the lead. We are on the brink of making major commercial contracts, and I really do hope that we're not prevented from doing so. My conscience is quite clear. I don't think that we would be aiding proliferation if we did. I believe on balance we would be preventing it. I think we would be helping the world to a better life, and that's going to reduce tension. I think one of the biggest threats to world peace in the future could very well be when nations start squabbling about a shortage of energy, if we really do get into this energy gap that you have been talking about.
That, then, is the case for the expansion of nuclear power as seen by the industry.